London, and I'll be co-chairing the session with...
Yeah, my name is Takuya from IOE, Institute of Education as well, and we are doing education and international development, master's course, and then, yeah, we're going to be co-chairing in this session, so welcome.
So we have two speakers today, Francesca Salvi and Catherine Dewey. Am I saying your names right?
Yeah.
sorry if I'm not. We're going to start with Francesca, who's also a student here at the University of Sussex, and she's doing a thesis on in-school pregnancy in Mozambique. Her work explores meanings attached to pregnancy as it occurs among young people in education, considering in particular how these meanings may hinder school enrollment and retention. Francesca strongly believes in multitasking. She grabs every opportunity to contribute to various issues in international education through, for instance, teaching and offering consultancies. So her talk today will be called Millennium Development Goals, Perverse Effects, Bridging the Gender Gap in Education in Mozambique. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Leila. I'm going to find out whether these works by Thatcher. Fine, I'll just use that, no problem. No, it's fine, I can just sit here, I've got the screen in front of me. Thank you very much. Millennium Development Goals, Perverse Effects, Bridging the Gender Gap in Education in Mozambique. When I got the advert of this conference today, I really jumped at the opportunity to look at my data under a completely different light. I'm not looking at the impact of the Millennium Development Goals, but I believe the case that I'm working on has something to say towards the goals. So I'm going to structure this brief talk today around specifically goal number 2 and number 3 that I'm going to remind all of us, including myself, in a second. And I'm going to look specifically at the context in Mozambique. And then I'm going to consider how a ministerial decree that has been developed in 2003 actually meets the aims of the goals, but at the same time runs the risk of creating perverse effect. I am arguing before that although the decree is aligned with the goals, it also creates a gender gap in education and increases what is already there, triggering some sort of a vicious cycle. So that's what I will do in my point number 4, unpack, which is the buzzword for every doctoral student. Right, just briefly reading through these two goals. Millennium Development Goal number 2, achieve universal primary education, and Millennium Development Goal number 3, promote gender equality and empower women. I'll leave you a couple of seconds to read them. Now, I'm sure you don't need a lot of reminding, it's probably more for myself, so my talk flows a little bit better. Now, what happens in Mozambique is quite interesting, because once we try to go and see what the causes for the gender gap in education might be, there's something that comes up quite strongly, and that's pregnancy and parenthood. As you can see, if we look at some data, which is always nice and a bit dry. There has been a decrease in the global fertility rates from the 80s until 2005, decreasing from 5.7 children per woman to 4.3. But this is not the entire story, because if we look at the contribution of younger people, we see that actually the mean age of the first baby has been going down. What does it mean? Well, this means that people are having the first child earlier and probably having less children throughout their life course. So this information explains why there's a bigger clash between education and pregnancy. So if people are having the first children earlier, there are more chances they are still in education, and there are going to be clashes between the two. So this is why about 39% of the dropouts at secondary level are actually deemed to be caused by pregnancy, and 9% at the primary level. Now, the question is, at this point, if pregnancies account for so much of the gender gap in education, how can we find a way to curb the number of pregnancies in order to allow more girls to remain in education? And a response has been Decree 39 GM 2003, which says that girls who get pregnant in school should be transferred to night courses. Also, there is a big emphasis on the partners of these girls, because clearly, if they are members of the school staff, they should be suspended, they should lose the job, some consequences should be on them as well. And these are the two main points that the decree puts in place in dealing with pregnancies within school context in Mozambique. Now, this seems to some extent a very happy ending, because there is a problem, there is a gender gap in education, there's been a general consensus that it should be bridged. There's the agreement that the gender gap is caused to a great extent by pregnancies, and now we've found a way to punish pregnancies in order to have less pregnancies in the long term. So the underlying assumptions is that the indications of this decree are going to act as a deterrent for other girls, because if you see other girls getting pregnant and being transferred to night courses, then you probably don't want to get pregnant yourself. At the same time, by removing pregnant girls from day courses, there is an attempt to denormalize the visibility of pregnancy within the school grounds. I hear some laughter. You don't believe that it's a very rational. Nor do I. And this is the reason why I started to pursue a PhD. I think that there was a lot of unpacking that needed to be done with this. And I didn't believe that the aim of increasing the gender gap in the short term would lead to a decrease, a lessened gender gap in the long term, so to speak. So what happens after months and months in fieldwork is that I found out a number of smaller aspects. Like, for instance, men are rarely penalised. That's because men that get girls pregnant are not necessarily studying at the same school. So it's not possible to transfer them to night courses because they're probably from the community. Likewise, if they are teachers or school staff within the schools, and Mozambique has a shortage of teachers, clearly, they're not going to be made redundant. The worst case scenario is that they're going to be transferred to another school, which has a lot of other problematics as well. What happens with girls? Well, you know, you may say, well, actually, why don't you look at the history of Mozambique? Like, clearly, maybe before these decree, girls were actually not allowed in the school, full stop. So these decree actually allows them to remain at school, even though they are transferred to the night courses. Well, yes and no, because transferring a girl to night course actually means that they're probably going to drop out at some point. Transport at night is not as frequent as it is during the day. It's also more dangerous to be out at night. And classes, I mean, there was a lot of talk about quality in Yusuf's session before. If quality is already an issue during the day, it's more of an issue at night when teachers are usually quite tired because they come from a day's work elsewhere. There may be problems with the structure, electricity cuts, especially in the countryside. And also, usually, there's not a lot of integration between a girl and the rest of the classroom, which may be composed by adults, because the reason why there are evening courses sometimes is to allow lifelong education and to allow older people to get an education where they didn't have the chance to. So, at the bottom of it lies a certain assumption. The reason why I think this decree doesn't work and is not going to bridge the gender gap in education in the long term is that it presupposes a certain type of pregnancy, a pregnancy that is unplanned, that is unwanted, that is contagious, so girls need to be removed. And it also presupposes a certain type of relation between pregnancy or childbearing and schooling, in the sense that they are mutually exclusive. Now, my fieldwork and my data have indicated a totally different situation. And I don't want to say that there are no pregnancies that are not wanted or that are not planned. Of course there are. But there are also a lot of pregnancies that are actually wanted. And this may be for a number of reasons. Because individuals are valued on the account of their offsprings, because there is a cultural preference for having children, because having a child is a way to state your reproductive capacity in front of the community, and actually sometimes puts you in a better position when you're about to get married, for instance. Because it strengthens relationships within families and also between the couple. And also sometimes it's a livelihood strategy, especially if a girl is hoping to get some sort of maintenance from the family of her partner. And I have found all of this, and I think all of this deserves respect and deserves to be visible in the process of achieving the gender equality in education. Also, I think it's very important not to apply Western concept to non-Western situations. For instance, pregnancy is not going to put a woman in a condition of total dependency, or it's not going to prevent her from doing other things in her life. This mainly because child rearing, parenting in Mozambique, like it is in many other countries, is not necessarily relying on the nuclear family. It's a shared task, and it's shared within the extended family, within the community. So in the same way that a woman is able to go to work, do something else with her time, in Mozambique, having a child does not prevent you from going to school. So just to conclude, I think this is the contribution that I would like to give to the post-15 debate. I think there is something to do with local sociocultural context and with local meanings that need to be considered. And just to link in with what Yusuf said before, there is something to be said about processes that leads to goals and ends. And they need to be included, they need to be part of the games. Getting to bridge the gender gap in education by 2015, 2020, 2030 is important, but so is the way to get there. And I believe the way to get there is to include local understandings and local meanings. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This was a really short presentation, but also we have some more time for questions. Maybe we can do this, what is it? Because the presentation was really interesting, so maybe we can just kind of share some ideas with our neighbors and then come back with some questions.